Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. Underground Club King here with another legendary video. So this is going to be something really interesting. It's about a guy by the name of Andrew Crispo. And if you've been in New York for most of your life, not necessarily, he was an art dealer, not really familiar with the art world or anything really like New York, legendary New York stories, you'll know who Andrew Crispo is. And let me give you a little bit of history. He was somebody, he grew up an orphan, bounced around from home to home, lived in France, lived in Italy, and came to New York. And he had a knack for the art world. And he had no artistic talent, but he was very smart, very handsome, very well-spoken, well-read. And he immediately fell in with the art community. He was openly gay, and the gay community loved him. Everybody loved him. He was just a very personable guy. And to make a long story short, he built up a reputation as an art dealer and a curator. And he ended up owning one of the largest galleries in the United States in New York City. It was in the Fuller Building, which I believe was on West 57th Street. Gorgeous gallery. It was about 15,000 square feet. It had occupied two floors. And he became known in the art world as you know, a player, a big player. And my father, Philip Marini, in the 60s and 70s, along with two of his colleagues at the time, they crossed paths with him. Because one of his colleagues was a bronze sculptor, and they bought and sold pieces by Maxwell Ernst, by Aristide Maillot, who's a famous French sculptor. And they knew of him. The art world was very close-knit community in New York. And if you were achieving any type of success, whether as an artist or a curator or as a financier, you knew each other. So Crispo, I became acquainted with him at the Vault. He would come there all the time, and over the years, we became very friendly. Very mild-mannered guy, never really bothered anybody, never engaged in any activity, sort of just hung out. We became friendly with a lot of art conversations. He gave me a couple of nice birthday gifts, which I showed in one of my Instagram posts. And the guy was, like, so overly nice that you didn't really get what he was all about. But later, if you looked in his eyes, sometimes people would say, I think Victor Hugo wrote it. I forget who actually wrote it. I'm not really an avid reader. But you can see evil in somebody's eyes. And it's not the person that's loud or boisterous or using profanity, or it's just something about your eyes. It really true is an old saying. It really is the windows into the soul. And you could see evil in this guy's eyes. Nothing about his demeanor said that, but you could just see it. And it was dark. There was a darkness there. And he would come back and forth to the Vault, and everything was, you know, so-so, blah, blah, blah. All of a sudden, something happened, and his whole other side came out. It was literally like two people living in one body. He used to like hanging out with young boys, not underage boys, like kids in their 20s. He was gay. That was his thing. He was into sadomasochism and into drugs. Very, very heavy pill user, cocaine user. Had a really, really beautiful, sick penthouse on Little West 12th Street. And he would have parties there. He hired an assistant by the name of Bernard Ligueros. I think he was Ecuadorian, I'm not sure. Young guy, handsome also, in his early 20s. And he became like Crispo's buddy. They would hang around all the time, this and that. Ligueros came from money. His parents owned a huge estate in Bedford, New York. So they would go up there when they weren't in the city, use the house because the parents were in Europe most of the time, and party up there. Okay, so one weekend, they hook up with a model by the name of Igel Vesti. He was a Swedish model who used to do the door at a club called The Limelight. Very, very successful Manhattan club on 19th Street. And they were partying together. So this Ligueros, Crispo, some other guys, and Igel Vesti spend the weekend partying, getting high at Ligueros' parents' estate in Bedford. To make a long story short, Igel Vesti ends up dead. He ends up shot in the head. He ends up, his body being burnt on the grounds. Nobody could figure out what happened. It came out later that Crispo, his thing was he didn't want to commit evil or do evil deeds, but he liked to orchestrate it. So during a drunken rage, he dared Bernard Lagueros to take one of his father's pistols and shoot Igor Vesti in the head. And he did it, because Lagueros would have done anything Chris Ball told him to. It was called a death mask murder, I think because they found a mask over his head, and it was a huge, huge story in New York. And what happened was, they could not convict Crispo of it, because Lagueros said, well, he told me to do it. And Crispo said, I didn't tell him to do it. His hands are, prints are on the gun, there's gunshot residue on his hands. He touched the guy's clothes, so Lagueros ended up getting 20 years in jail. And that became a string of Crispo's evil coming out. 2 years later, he was having a party in his penthouse on Little West 12th Street, and a young kid about 22, 23 years old ended up diving off the balcony onto the West Side Highway. Obviously, he was dead. And everybody said, well, Crispo dared him to do it. And, you know, the cops are saying, listen, you keep telling me these stories. If you're standing there, someone dares you to jump into traffic and you do it, you're an idiot. Or you're mentally disturbed, or you're high on drugs. We can't convict somebody for telling you to do something. He had no part in the murder. And then Crispo, further things started to happen with him. He had a mansion, which we went to a couple of times for parties, in Quag, Long Island. Beautiful, beautiful mansion. Oh my God. Right, waterfront, everything. Crispo needed money. His drug use and everything was spiraling out of control. So he had the mansion filled with forgeries. He started to get into forgeries. And the real artwork he had stashed away. So he burns down the mansion in Quag, right? This is all public record. But we found it out. He actually told us about it before it was public record. He burns down the mansion. Now Chubb, which is a big insurance company like Allstate and State Farm, he put in a claim for about $7 million. They didn't want to pay him. And what happened was, this guy was so devious and evil. He had such big balls that he did burn down the mansion. It was arson, but he did it in such a advanced way that they couldn't prove it. Now, with insurance companies, most people don't know. I think they have 120 days because they don't want to pay you. No insurance companies want to pay you. They want to take the premiums and never pay you. But in 120 days after you file a claim, people know this because I didn't know this. They have to pay you or charge you with fraud. They can't just say, well, we're investigating. We don't believe you. If you don't believe me, there has to be enough physical evidence to charge me with fraud or you have to pay me. So Crispo knew that and he sued them. He sued the insurance company and he won. They paid him, I think, like $8.5 million, including legal fees. So now he was back flush with cash. But trouble found him again with the whatchamacallit, with the IRS. And he ended up owning a couple million dollars. They sentenced him to like 5 years in jail. Now, this was a guy who was not only gay, but was a masochist. So he loved gay sex and he loved getting beaten. So when he comes out of jail, he comes to the vault. It was like a couple of years later. We have a party for him. I'm sitting with him in the lounge with Janet Carpenter, at that time the owner, a couple other people. And we said, Andrew, how was jail? He goes, you know what? It really wasn't that bad. He goes, my second night there, he goes, two big guys came. They beat me. They tied me up. They raped me. They spit on me. They called me names. And he said, I went back to my cell. I said, wow, this is not that bad. This could be fun. This is true. I swear. That was a quote of his. And then he got in trouble for stalking his lawyer's daughter because his lawyer had a check due to him, which he didn't get. And he had implied that he was going to hurt her daughter. He went back to prison, out of prison, back in prison. And it was just his life kind of spiraled out of control at that point. But it was just, I thought this was an interesting story. I've never met an individual like that. I mean, I've met crazy people. I've met gangsters and murderers and rapists and priests and nuns and kind people and philanthropists. But this guy was like two people in one. If you sat and had a conversation about the art world, he was so well-spoken, so kind, so gentle. Did not use profanity, did not make sexist remarks, did not say anything that would say this guy is a bad guy. But then he had this evil in him. He liked to see harm come to people. And he liked severe beatings, giving and receiving. And it was just a whole thing. There was a book written about him, which is fascinating. If you love New York, like, you will love my book, The Vault, 1016. I guarantee you everybody's going to love it. And if you love New York, New York history, if you love the art world, if you love the underground world, what New York was in the 80s and 90s is a great place to be before it became some cookie cutter piece of shit, which it is now. But get a book. It's called Bag of Toys. I can't think of the author. It's a hardcover book called Bag of Toys. And it details Crispo's life. It details the art world and the whole underground New York City. Going back to earlier days when pop art, you know, first came out. The brilliance of Andy Warhol with the Factory. The Keith Harrings, the Jean-Michel Basquiat's, all the way to the present-day Banksy's. And it's a brilliant, fascinating story. You guys should pick it up. I hope you like this story. I'm going to keep reminding you about the book, 1016, everywhere. And you guys enjoy your day. I'll see you in the next one.